Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to another broadcast of Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John DeVita Broadcast Center on the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network and Jack FM 89.7 WRHS FM Norwich on Thursday at 1 o'clock p.m. on December the 29th, the year 2016. And now, here he is, Mr. Fred Belcastro.
Smiling.
When you're smiling,
and the whole world smiles with you. And when you're laughing,
when
the sun comes shining through. When you're crying, you bring on the rain.
Stop your sighing,
won't you be happy again?
When you're smiling,
keep on smiling, and the world will.
Good morning and welcome to the Wealth and Wisdom program. My name is Fred Belcastro, your host, and then during the next 30 minutes, we're going to talk about how we can use our wisdom to grow and protect our wealth. And as usual, we're broadcasting from the John DeVita Broadcast Center here on the northwest side of Chicago. And of course, you know you're listening to us on Jack FM 89.7 WRHS out of Norridge, Illinois. Again, we talk about the opportunities that we have and using wisdom to grow and protect our wealth. Do we watch our wealth? Do we see our wealth? Do we see our money? Do we watch our money? Do we control our money? You know, one of the four C's. What were the four C's? Well, control, right? Liquidity, use, and control of our money. If somebody else controls our dollars, are they really our dollars? If we take control of our money, isn't that using a bit of our wisdom? How about compounding? We talk about compounding all the time, compounding the money, the great wonder of the world. I think we did a whole 30 minutes one time on compounding money and how it was supposed to be the eighth wonder of the world, and Einstein said so, and so that makes it so, and we're going to compound. And I'd like to know how many people really compound. I see very few. I've been doing this now for, admittedly, over 50 years. Very few people have ever compounded their money. How can you possibly count? For the most of individuals, I find that they have their dollars in retirement plans, at least for the next, from 1980 on, so that's what, 30 years? It was 78. But nevertheless, if they have their money in mutual funds, we did an explanation on the mutual funds and how they vacillate or how they go up and down. We used to talk about vacillating. Does that word denote to you a big drop-off, a big spike, one way or the other? It doesn't. And so that word vacillate means that they quiver a little bit. They just shake up and down like that blue line that John DeVita keeps my voice in the controls. It's just a little vacillating, just a little quivering. It's just a little bit up and down. But that's not the case. That spikes. We know that a few years ago, individuals lost up to 40% of the value of their retirement plans because of a vacillating or a quivering. Come on, let's be realistic. You can't compound money if your money loses from time to time. And that's what mutual funds are. So there's really no compounding in that. How about lost opportunity? Cost. Do you figure lost opportunity costs, or is that just an accounting principle that's used for companies? You say doesn't that apply to you and I with our dollars? Aren't our dollars just as important, if not more important, to us than a corporation's accounting system? We'd be foolish if we didn't take that into consideration. Collateral capacity, the other C. So there's four C's: control, compounding, cost, meaning opportunity cost, and of course, collateral capacity. What's your collateral capacity? Do you know? If I say those words to you, and I've talked about them for the last couple of years here, using some wisdom, Please, you've got to use wisdom. And so when I say to individuals that I believe that there's more opportunity to serve my clients by helping them first avoid the big losses. Avoid the losses. Keep what you have. Take a look at what you're going to accumulate during your working years. From age 25 to 65, that's a 40-year period of time. That's where I'll start most of the conversations with individuals. The total amount of wealth that they've captured during their lifetimes, and whoops, what happened? Like the sands on a beach, they go through your toes, the dollars go through your fingers. See, there's only two ways that we can serve you, and we just beat the horse to death in the financial service business by finding better products. You've got this is going to potentially pay higher returns, higher interest, higher risk. But we don't care about the risk, you know, as long as I can make money. I don't know how many financial products there really are. We never took a pencil to it. And see, there's a lot of them because the examinations in Series 6 and 7, 24, that I accumulated, there was a whole lot of things, a range of subjects and investments that we had to know. There's a lot of it different. How come there's not just one? In other words, if there was just one, wouldn't we all gravitate to that one? Yet you have everybody on the radio, everybody on TV, every article that's written in the financial journals and papers talking about different products. Or like I say, different clubs. Do you need a club to play the game? Yeah. Do you need the product? Yeah. But is there one best one? No, there isn't. If there was just one, then everybody would be there. It would probably no longer be a good investment. Maybe Bernie Madoff, maybe he has the answer to it. Somewhere along the line, someone's got the answer to it. No, they don't. But you know what? This is the holiday season. Everybody was Merry Christmas because of the birth of Christ. Everybody is celebration. Everybody is saying, excuse me, pardon me, with a smile on our faces, enjoying good cheer, singing those age-old songs denoting about the birth of a Christ. Everybody's happy and yet we sometimes overlook what we have to get back to and realize that we've got to be more efficient with our resources that we already have. Not saying that we take anything away from the holidays, but yet wealth and wisdom comes back down to reality. And so what I talk about the beliefs that people have concerning their money, it's very real to me because I've seen so much misinformation, and we've talked about that misinformation, the information that we get. It's not planning, not fail to plan. It's planning all wrong and going on these bases. And we talked about the fact that we're going to be in lower tax brackets at age 65, and whoops, somewhere along the line we find out that's not the case. And so I say to you, gee, how you doing? How's your ship of wealth coming along? Are you gaining or are you losing? Do you see what you're doing? Do you have a picture? Do you have a plan? Do you have an idea of the flow of your money? I mean, it goes in one hand and out the other. We can joke about that. We used to joke about saving money and accumulating money, much like a roller coaster, up and down and up and down. But do we have a picture? Do we have a model showing our money from the moment that we receive it, the moment it comes into our hands and until it's consumed? When it's consumed, it's lost. It's lost forever. Do you see the people that I talk about, people shopping and all the money that they're saving? I said to more than a couple of people, how do you save money by spending? Where's the saving in spending money? You know, what is your model, your economic model have to say with that? You know, everybody has one. I talk about everybody having a personal economic model. There are those that can see it, can realize it, understand it, and then they begin to create and cultivate and keep their wealth in a tax-efficient manner. And then there's that don't know what I'm talking about. And some of these people, unfortunately, tend to live paycheck to paycheck. So what I'm talking about is very real, and it's a very important facet of wisdom, just to have clarity with what we're doing, where our money's going. And let me tell you, and I've talked about the 21 areas of wealth transfers where we just give our money away knowingly or unknowingly. You'd think that, and I used to say that if we knew that we were doing it, we certainly wouldn't do it. And that turned out to be baloney. That's a bunch of malarkey. You don't want to hear any more misinformation, more malarkey, because sometimes we do it knowing it's not the smart thing to do, but gosh darn it, we do it anyway. And you tell me, if we were to sit down and over a cup of coffee and say, is that very smart? Nah. Everybody would say, nah, that's not the right answer. That's not very smart. Yet we'll go right out here to the plaza or wherever it is that we transact our business and put things on revolving charges and credit cards and buy ourselves a big hunk of debt and not thinking anything about paying it off. You know, when you pay off the debt, you're handcuffing yourself for your future lifestyle. Where does this money come from to pay down this debt? It comes from your lifestyle. So wait. So I'm going to say that there's more of an opportunity for me to help my clients by exposing and releasing them from the burdens of these transfer costs, from transferring their money away, than there is in trying to pick a winner. Remember, I think it's going to come in the next in a few weeks. Somebody will from Barron's or the Journal will get a chimpanzee and put up a sheet of stocks and have the chimp throw a dart and try to beat it. He's outperformed most of the professionals in the last recallable years. One of the things I'll talk about, though, in using wealth, using wisdom to protect our wealth, is our homes. We did a couple of shows on the types of mortgages, and I could ask you now, as regular listeners to the program, what's the best type of mortgage to have? We discussed it fully. You know, is your home really the best place to park money? One of the questions that came in some time ago. So you think you're safe? You think you're any safer by having your home paid off? Listen, my grandparents lost their home during the Depression, so we could resurrect those individuals and say, absolutely, it's a better. Would that be the case today? How about those of you who are retired? Is your home paid for? Would you be better off having a mortgage during your retirement? You got to be kidding me, Fred. What are you, nuts? Who wants a mortgage during your retirement? I want the home all paid for. Is that smart? Is that the smartest thing to do? Let me ask you. Let me really come out and ask you. Did you put this all down on a ledger? Did you make a plan and look at all these dollars and expenses and transfer costs? Have you looked at the various alternatives? Did you plug in paying off the mortgage with a 30-year mortgage? Did you look at plugging in the figures, looking at it for a 15-year mortgage? Did you plug in taking the distribution for retirement from this plan, that plan, that taxable plan? It's all right to say, oh, you're better off deferring your taxes and deferring your taxes, you know. Is it? Have you put it down? Do you have a plan? Do you see what different alternative would help you have more money or more spending dollars or a greater lifestyle during your retirement? And at the same time, avoiding giving all of that money away and unnecessary wealth transfers? Did you put it down on a plan where you could look at several assets all at one time and then choose the method of distribution that best meets your retirement needs? Have you done that? See, if you haven't done that, then don't tell me it's better to do this or it's better to do that. That's silly. That's like umpiring a baseball game without seeing the play. Have you seen the play? Have you seen what's happening to your dollars? Have you created a journal and a balance sheet or an income statement to see? I do that every day for clients. Give me a call, area 630-673-4360. That's using wisdom. That's being smart. Why don't we take a break? Give me a chance to have a sip of coffee now and cool down. Then we'll talk about
darling,
some other things.
You send me. I know you send me. Darling, you send me. Honest you do, honest you do, honest you do. Whoa. Lasted so long. Now I find myself wanting to marry you and take you home. Whoa, you send me. I know you send me. I know you send me. Honest you do. Take you home. I know you send me. I know you send me. Oh, you send me. Honest you do.
Mr. Sam Cooke in 1957, You Send Me. And as you're listening to this program this afternoon and Thursdays, realize that this is the last show we'll be doing in 2016. Next time you hear us, we'll be into the new year of 2017. And I'm pounding the table saying I'm really going to lose weight. Next year, I'm going to lose weight. I'm going to start the... January 1st, maybe the 2nd, I'm going to draw a line in the calendar, definitely going to start, I'm going to have all kinds of good intentions, come on, why don't we make a resolution to do something to take a look at our finances a little bit. Don't forget the rules have changed. We've gone from accumulating at some time of our life and to time of distribution. And why don't we put it down on paper, the ability to then illustrate the results of different spending methods. You know, what we want to do is apply some wisdom. Take a look at the numbers. Let's be smart about it, not just say, yeah, we'll be fine. You know, looking at the numbers, I think, will give you an invaluable lesson to protect the most valuable assets that you have. The focus is that you want to maximize the spending opportunities, and release or liquidate the least assets first. Well, yeah, you know that, but we have to supply some wisdom to it. And one of the facets of that wisdom that I follow, and I say this almost tongue in cheek, that I'm in the belief changing business. You ready? Everything that you grown up to believe, and I've said, if you find something out now that proves not to be true, when do you want to know about it? Do you ever want to change it? Do you want to make any changes in your focus of money? And so when we find out something that we believed to be true all these years turns out not to be true, when do we want to know about it? And maybe we don't. Maybe we don't want to know anything about it. One question is our homes, the equity in our homes. Is it really a good place to park your money? No, I'm not telling you to withdraw your equity. I'm not saying that. I'm saying as far as your belief system is concerned concerning money, is the home really a good place to park your money? If I ask that question to 99% of the people, I say, of course it is, Fred. Of course it is. It's safety. It gives me a feeling of comfort and peace of mind. And I will run into a situation and people have a 15-year mortgage, and I know that they feel that they have that short mortgage, that the answer to that question, is it a good place to park their money? It's going to be yeah. Yeah, that's why I paid off my home as quickly as possible. In fact, anything less than a 30-year-old mortgage would tell me that they believe their home is a good place to accumulate their money or keep their money safe. Look, you can agree or not agree that your home is a good place to put your money intellectually, but how are you paying for your mortgage? And how you pay for your mortgage will really illuminate, really tell me your true belief about money. An important thing for us all to keep in mind is that the homes on the blocks, the beautiful homes on the block, all decorated, all with the holiday season, the home next door appreciates the same. Whether or not he has the home paid off, or whether he has it mortgaged to the hilt or financed 100%, have you ever thought about that? The guy next door, he has his home paid off. Is his going to appreciate it more than yours if you have it financed? See, it's not. With appreciation of homes, the value of the home has nothing to do with what you owe on it. I know it affects the equity. I'm talking about the appreciation of the home itself. And that's true. That's true. There's no changing that. You understand that the money in your home doesn't earn anything. If you have all of your money in your house or you have no money in your home, the appreciation of the property is the same. Not your equity, the appreciation of the property. And so all the dollars that we have in our home, what are they earning? They're earning nothing. Does that mean we shouldn't have equity in our homes? I'm not saying that. It may be for some individuals, it may be the case. May for others, not the case. What's your plan call for? What does it look like on paper with all of your other assets, with all of your lifestyle responsibilities? If you don't have that, well, then you could just give any old answer, and you're right. You know, if that's how you feel. But when you calculate the rate of return on the growth of your appreciation, you got to remember that the amount that you have in the house doesn't make any difference. Everybody's home is going to appreciate the same. Now, I know that if you take better care and you shovel the snow and you fix the front steps, you do the window. I understand that. I'm talking about general appreciation. If your home is appreciating at a fast rate, doesn't it make sense that you'd be even better if you were getting that kind of appreciation of your home without having your money tied up in it? You see, if you have your money tied up in the home, are you in control of the dollars, or is the bank in control? Another way to look at it is, if I can explain it, say if our home is appreciating, but your money in the home is not earning anything. You're getting one return on your equity, but no growth on the money you put down or prepay. Do you understand that? We went through the figures of applying the better choice as far as mortgage is concerned. Remember, we did a program, well, we may do it sometime in the future, putting 100% down, just buying the home outright for cash, or putting down the minimum of 10 or 20%, putting down 50%, or carrying the mortgage with a 50% ownership or an 80%. See, with a mortgage, you had the potential of your money to make more money than your mortgage payment. If that's the case, well, then we can get to the conclusions in a few minutes. But let me just listen to one more tune before we end the program.
Return to me, oh my dear, I'm so lonely. Hurry back, oh my love, hurry back, I am yours. Return to me, for my heart wants you only. Hurry home, won't you please hurry home to my heart. My darling, if I hurt you, I'm sorry. Forgive me, and please say you are mine. Return to me. Please come back, Bella Mia. Hurry home to my arms, to my lips and my heart. Cara mia, ti amo. Solo tu, solo tu, solo tu, mio
As soon as that song begins and you hear the background music, you know that it's Dean Martin with Return to Me from 1958. Oh, you might not recall the year, but there's no doubt about who's singing that song, Mr. Dean Martin. We talk about a confusing subject, you know. Listen to me, I know it's always better to put your money in the home. I had learned that, and I said I'm in the belief changing business. Have you looked at it as far as your plan is concerned? Have you spent a few dollars to put all this down, to have an accountant put all this down on paper for you, so you could make an intelligent decision? Don't forget Wealth and Wisdom. What'd you expect me to talk about? I'm going to talk about changing some of the beliefs, because we're going to apply just a little bit more wisdom to it, and just not hearsay or information that we've picked up through the years and saying, yeah, it's better to do this, it's better to do this. And then when we talk about the liquidity use and control, you go, yeah, I control my money. Well, if the bank's got your down payment and money, you don't control that, do you? You know, how is that money compounding? Well, it's saving money. No, is it money compounding? We just said it's better to control and compound, right? Is it compounding? No, it's not. Come on, let's use some wisdom. How about, what's the opportunity cost on the money you just gave the bank for the down payment? They require 20%, you put 40% down. You're a lot smarter. What's the opportunity cost on that additional $20,000? What did that cost you? Have you figured that? Well, and if you had collateral capacity with that money, would you really have to put it down? You see? The fact that your mortgage payment is mostly interest during the early part of the years gives you a tremendous tax advantage, reducing the cost and the risk involved in keeping the money invested. See? Take a look. You've got to have a plan. You've got to schedule these things. You've got to look at it. You've got to plug in one interest rate versus another interest rate versus a deduction versus an accumulation versus a compounding versus collateral capacity. An opportunity cost all have to be considered. Put them on a ledger. Take a look. Make some changes. Plug them in one way. Plug them in an alternative way. You've got to be able to make an intelligent decision based on what is, not what you heard over the coffee shop or what your grandfather or great-grandfather did back during the Depression. All right, that's our time. That's our time for this year. We're done with 2016 now. Next time you'll be listening to me and I'll have the privilege of talking to you, it'll be 2017. We'll all be a little bit older and a little bit we'll be a little bit older and a little bit wiser. In the meantime, why don't we take care of one another and make somebody smile? Thanks for listening to me. Enjoyed talking to you. Thanks for supporting the station.
And Fred, on behalf of the entire staff here at the John DeVito Broadcast Center and the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network and WRHS-FM Norwich, I want to wish you, your wife, and the entire family a very happy, healthy, and blessed new year. And thanks for being part of our great system here at the John DeVito Broadcast Center.
Thanks, John.
When you're smiling,
an old man smiles with you.
And when you're laughing, when the sun comes shining through. When you're crying, you bring on the rain.
Stop your sighing.
Won't you be happy again?
When you're smiling,
keep on smiling, and the world will smile.
You have been listening to Wealth and Wisdom with Fred Belcastro from the John DeVito Broadcast Center on Jack FM 89.7 WRHS-FM Norwich and the Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network on a special broadcast Thursday, December the 29th, the year 2016. This program will return again next Friday as scheduled. This broadcast was directed by John DeVito. Our special thanks to radio station manager Kevin Zeflik of WRHS-FM Norwich and the executive producer of Windy City Hometown Entertainment Network, Mr. John Chiconda. Until next time, please be safe and thanks for listening. And today's broadcast was pre-recorded on Wednesday, December the 28th, the year 2016. And this is Jack FM 89.7 WRHS-FM, Norwich, Illinois. Happy New Year, everyone. Be safe and enjoy.